everyone, and welcome to Season 9, Episode 19 of Canton's Podcast. Still, just about the only podcast exclusively covering the whole of the North West Canton Football League. You know, familiar faces by now. To my right is Mr. Martin Fallon, the man with 12 jobs. He is League Results Coordinator, League IT Guy, League Stato. He is Mr. League Media. He is...
Groundhop Organiser.
Groundhop Organiser, yep. Yeah. Amongst others, and league director, league management committee member, and pretty much whatever else he fancies, really, just takes it. But anyway, Mr. Martin Fallon, ladies and gentlemen. And of course, I'm your host for this episode. I am Gary Landy. I am the league director, the league management committee member, league safeguarding and welfare officer, and whatever else I get asked to do, it's what we do. Yep. Anyway, Martin. Episode 19. Is this the first one of the year, or is it the second?
I think it's the first, to be honest.
I think it is. You had the squeaky voice, and then we were both sort of bogged down by chaos.
But for those listeners and watchers who don't know, I had laryngitis start of the year.
Nice.
So everyone was relieved because I couldn't speak for 5 days.
Yeah, but you could flip an email.
We had quite a comical... league management meeting.
Where
Debbie and Ian were chuckling every time I tried to speak.
I think I just all kept a straight face just until the end.
Oh, and what's his name? Peter Stokes, is it? Oh, I can't remember. No, not Peter. Former referee fella.
I
forgot.
Yeah.
I'm getting old.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice fella.
Yeah. Anyway, we're coordinated today, Gary.
Of course, we show our colours.
Yeah.
What we do. Yes, I think we've both got non-stop commitments out of the week, so I think we just ended up looking rather cool for the occasion.
Well, apart from the fact it's freezing as well, so...
Well, it is a bit crisp, yeah. Struggling to find football at the moment, but I think we'll come to that in a wee while, actually. There's been a lot of business around the league, but there's not been too much football, certainly in the last couple of weeks. It's happened when it's mattered, but any managerial movements, anything like that, Martin? I can only think of one, really.
There's one, which I haven't got to add.
Asheville. Yeah, Steve Murphy left Asheville, and I think Gary Jones has come in.
Yeah, I think Gary on the staff anyway, I think. So
might have been, yeah. He's already got the nickname Mojo. So if you've got a nickname somewhere, you must be pretty well in with them.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm not really...
He's got a punch on the sticky sweets from the 80s.
Not really up to speed on managerial changes because, you know, again, clubs don't send us anything.
No. As league media man, Mark, you should be...
Not man.
Tell me.
You know,
tell you, odds are it's going to end up in the regional papers and the non-league paper.
Yeah, it's just like, you know...
Just putting that out there.
We're meant to mind read when games get postponed because of waterlogged pitches or frozen pitches and clubs don't tell us and it doesn't go on the league.
Yeah, but to be fair, even managing committee think that you're a mind reader sometimes.
You know, we don't tell us. We don't know.
Anyway,
rocket science.
Let me just send you this thought, Martin. Well, you get that one. So anyway, right, the weather. It probably hasn't affected you in sunny Portugal, but it's been flipping Baltic here.
I've got a hat on. It's cold today.
Yeah, that's just a fashion statement. Can't fool me. You're still into your 90s grunge music and wear a beanie at every occasion. You wear a beanie for the apocalypse.
I was more a rave guy.
Oh, drop an F. Whatever it is you crazy cats used to do over the weekend. Of course, I've been working since I was 16, so I missed all that. Hey-ho.
Well, you've got must have a good pension. Anyway.
If I live long enough to take it, or we have a civil war, which would probably crash the banking system and wipe it out. But yeah, if it's there, it's there.
Yeah.
So yeah, the weather's back.
There's been a lot of games off though, hasn't there? Really?
Yeah, I take it it's kept you busy being a results coordinator and the likes of it.
Yeah. It's daft. It is daft, really. I mean, what are we on now? The 19th.
19th as we record, 20th yeah. as we release.
Yeah, so that from since the 1st of January, even, there's been 68 postponements.
It's not good. You know. I know we had a little bit of wiggle room with regards to match days and availability of, but obviously a lot of that will be challenged.
Yeah, well, obviously them 68 postponements have got to go back into the calendar. So there's a league rule, basically, that says any postponements must be played within 42 days of the original date. That's not... It's basically what they call a standardised rule. So it's rules that are imposed on all leagues in the National League system by the FA.
Well, it's the same for us. It's the same for the Northern Counties East. It's the same for combined counties. Whoever.
Well, the same for the
it's up to
everything.
It's up to all concerned to get it done.
Yeah, so basically, we've applied a bit of common sense. So, if you look at Bury, for example, they're pretty full every Saturday and midweek until, for the next 2 months. There isn't a window to put a game in 42 days. So we've applied a little bit of common sense where if you can't do it in the next 42 days, it'll be on the next available midweek after that. Where both clubs are available. And then, once it's good, we are going to get to a point though where, all the midweeks are full for the remainder of the season, and clubs are going to have to start playing three times a week, Saturday, Tuesday, Thursday, or Saturday, Monday, Thursday, whatever, really. Just because we're running out of time, the season has got to finish on the dates that it finishes because them dates are laid down by the FA because the playoffs have got to be finished by the 29th of April.
Yeah, it's a fair comment. And I mean, just earlier on as well, there was a question from George Crickfoot on Twitter who came through and asked us the question as well about the possibility of extending dates. And obviously, we've responded to George about roughly how it works. But these dates are imposed, the set in stone. Because at the end of the day, it's not just about getting your league fixtures done. You've got to get your cups in. Then you've got to get all your business attended to. Then you've got to get your AGM in. And of course, but then there's the reshaping of any leagues that might need doing. And we'll come to that in a minute. But yeah, there's business to attend to. It's not just the football. That's part of the football season. There's business and admin that needs attending to as well.
Yeah, so as it got to stand, basically, the First Division North and South will finish on the 15th of April.
Mm-hmm.
Also known as Grand National Day in our neck of the woods, Curry.
Referee. Thanks for that.
So, yeah.
Let's see how much leave I've got.
Yeah. So, yes, 15th of April, that's when the First Division North and South finishes. It's the 22nd of April for the Premier Division.
Right.
And the reason for that is, like I say, the playoffs have got to be done by the 29th of April. So what we do is the First Division North and South, they'll then have the playoff semi-finals on the 22nd, playoff final on the 29th. For the Premier Division, whoever finishes runner-up will go into that step 4-5 playoff, for a place in the Northern Premier League on the 29th of April.
It's worth mentioning as well, innit? We are on the ball with regards to things like bank holidays and the coronation weekend.
We
don't just leave that be until it's sort of on the horizon, but we're already looking at potential.
So you mentioned cups there, Gary. Obviously we can plan them when we need to. But what we've said as a league, I think it is the because obviously let me get my dates up just so I've got them. They're in May, aren't they? First Monday in May is the 1st.
Yeah.
So that's May Day, bank holiday. That will be the, I think it's First Division playoff final, the Edward Case Cup.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
Isn't the Edward Case the actual First Division Cup? It's not the playoff one, is it?
No. Yeah, the playoff will be on the 29th.
Yeah.
Saturday. So the Edward Case Cup final, it'll be on that bank holiday Monday,
right?
Which is the 1st of May. And then the following weekend, we do have another bank holiday, which is for King Charles's coronation, which I think is on the Saturday. So we're going to have our Macron Cup final on the 8th of May this year.
So that's still quite late, bearing in mind, obviously, the league AGM's in early June. So yeah. We are taking it as far as we possibly can without taking the mick.
Yeah.
Mick Ainsworth.
Mick! Yeah. Sorry, Mick.
Sorry, Mick. Sorry. Yeah, that's never mind.
That's the one. Yeah. He couldn't stop laughing. Because I was literally,
hello, everybody. Yes, thank you.
As soon as I opened my mouth, I said all the people just going.
All the shiny white teeth appeared across all 10, 11 boxes or whatever it was.
Wait till you get laryngitis. I'll be laughing on Zoom. Anyway.
Be the only one.
Yeah.
Right, so that's where we're at with regards to the date so far.
For the playoffs, there's, you know, rearrangements. You know, as we covered the other week, clubs have 7 days to get them, get a date between themselves, or else the...
And the clubs have got to have this input, haven't they? It's not just the almighty league from the ivory towers shouting down, we're going to play it on that date. The clubs have got to take the lead on any initiative and start the proceedings.
You know, I'll take two really good, well-run clubs in Runcorn Town and Ilkley Town.
Okay. Yeah, we'll go with that.
Last Tuesday.
We're talking off the pitch here in Runcorn. I was saying that. Your results are improving. So I'll just shut up.
They've got a 100% win record this year, Gary. Just looking it.
Good to know.
Yeah. Anyway, forgot what I was saying. Oh, yeah, last Tuesday the game got called off because of a frozen pitch. And we spoke between ourselves and said we'll rearrange it for next Tuesday. So it's us being proactive and getting it in place, you know, which is what clubs should do, because then they get the dates that they want them. You know, cannot be pouring it in and after 7 days on a date to be decided, really.
I mean, a lot of clubs are proactive, aren't they? They get it done. There's just somewhere that there's maybe a lenience towards the date, or they're trying to get hold of a manager to run dates by them, and then so it can drag on sometimes. It's sometimes not easy, but there's still that expectation to get it in within the 42 days.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like it's a short time, is it? But obviously, like us, everyone looks X weeks ahead.
Well, it's not long. What's 42? 7/7s are 49. So 6 weeks, isn't it?
Yeah. There's still a decent time frame.
Yeah, but you look at someone like Bury, for example. I know it's because they've been successful in the Cup and they've been successful in the Vase.
Yeah.
And they've had more games called off than probably anybody. But I'm just looking at theirs. So Saturday the 21st, which is this Saturday, they're playing Saturday, Tuesday, Saturday, Tuesday, Saturday, Monday, Saturday, Tuesday, Saturday, Tuesday, Saturday, Tuesday, Saturday, Tuesday. And that takes us up to the 12th of March. So then next free midweek is on the, you know, the 15th of March.
Obviously, so got one.
They'll be full soon. Their midweeks will be full, and they will be playing three, possibly four times a week.
Admittedly, the weather forecast ain't great for this weekend.
But... like I say, I've got to take your hat off to Bury as well, I think, because, you know, this week, I guess we're going to come on to results in a minute, but they played their FA Vase fourth round tie. It was postponed on Saturday, but they played it at Darwin. You know, and that's them being proactive, I think, because they've identified they've got a problem with Radcliffe. You know, is there too many games on that pitch? We obviously can't take it because we're getting a lot of games called off. Obviously, the ground maintenance is out of Bury's hands. They can't do anything about it. But they have been proactive, and they've sought an all-weather pitch, and they've got the game on this week, which is good.
Fair play to them. Okay, mate. So that's where we're at with regards to weather impact. So we have a look at some recent results, because the results that have taken place, by and large, have been quite notable, because obviously we're talking Vase results, we're talking league results, and that, by and large, has prompted movements around the league.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So I'll just bring up some recent results.
Well, I guess the biggest result from a league point of view was on Tuesday evening this past week, when Withenshaw Town, who were the top of the Premier Division, faced Vauxhall Motors, who was second.
Yeah. What a game.
And, you know, a pretty surprising from an outsider's point of view scoreline of 3-0 to Vauxhall Motors. Goals from Michael Burkey, Lewis Buckley and Ben Duff and Kelly. You know, a cracking 3-0 win that, which sent Vauxhall to the top of the table. Brilliant.
Yeah. It's going to be... I think it's going to be a bit of a roller coaster ride between now and the end of the season, but that's good for the league. Not great for clubs and managers and probably turning their hair the same colour as mine, but for us as fans of football, it's great to see that competition already. And all the clubs that are challenging in all the divisions are doing it on merit. They're not just sort of being lucky with the odd couple of results here. They've really hammered it, haven't they?
Yeah. I mean, it's good because, you know, you've got Withenshaw and Vauxhall sort of challenging up there, but they're not the only ones. You know, Avro and AFC Liverpool are sort of up there within five leaders of Vauxhall now.
I was going to mention that because whilst we're talking about midweek, is AFC Liverpool and Avro played last night. Very different results as well.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, AFC Liverpool running out 5-0 winners, which is a great one. And then Avro getting beat at home by... Longridge Town, who were in the bottom two at the you know, at kickoff, and fighting for the line for points for their own reason, really.
Yeah, it's really interesting times. I mean, you have to take your hats off to AFC Liverpool. They tend to beat whoever comes onto the doorstep.
But Avro even further down the table, Gary. You know, Congleton Town have played 23 compared to like Withenshaw's 26. So
yeah.
If they win those 9 points. You know, they're within 3 points of Withenshaw Town, which is, you know, they're down there at the minute, but they're not out of it. Bury have got 7 games in hand on Withenshaw Town, so they'll actually go above them should they win them. I know it's a big ask, and I've always said that this time of the season, you'd rather have points on the board than games in hand. But
yeah, absolutely.
You know, you can't, as I remember, Widnes showing and Bootle showing the other year, you can go on a run, a ridiculous run this time of year. I remember Widnes won 20 odd on the spin and Bootle won 20 odd on the spin, didn't they? So it can happen.
Oh, yeah, can absolutely. Kudos as well to Steeton, who got their game on at home to South Liverpool. That was 1-1, I think it was Tuesday night. An interesting result.
I spoke with Billy, because obviously Runcorn were playing the Ilkley, and he said, woke up, snow everywhere, you know, because they're quite elevated, Steeton, aren't they? And you know, I know they've got an all-weather pitch, but to get the game on, kudos to them. Brilliant.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I think what's notable with these pitches as well is rain tends not to phase them. Snow doesn't seem to worry. It's when it turns to ice or when it freezes over. If you get rain down on them and then it freezes, then that's when it starts putting a bit of a question mark on. But it can pretty much take anything that's relatively fresh on it. But if you get that legacy of ice, then you know, obviously you've got to look at the safety aspect of it.
That was
a good game to get on, and probably a good point from South Liverpool's perspective. Steeton, obviously Roy there probably preferred the three, but I think if he did that, he could take a point. Worth mentioning as well, Withenshaw Amateurs beating Stafford Town 2-0 the other night as well.
Yeah, great
win for Withenshaw.
They're second in the table anyway, but that moved them to within 3 points. I think they're 2 points behind actually of Stockport Town. So, you know, going great guns, to be honest.
A couple of games on Monday night as well. Also in the, I think it was in the south, because Abbey Hay went to Main Road and won 2-0. And Stockport Town tonked Brockton. 5-0, what a result. That's no easy feat. And you know, I'd say that as a compliment to Brockton. Yeah. Brockton are a good side this year. Stockport Town, though, that they do love the real deal.
Well, we had a roving reporter at that game, didn't we? Who said Brockton didn't turn up, really. It's just one of those days. But Stockport are home. And, well, let me have a look at the home form of Stockport. Because I bet it's great, to be honest.
Well, it wouldn't surprise me in the slightest.
That's form table. Okay, Stockport at home. Wow, there you go. Played 11, won 11.
Can't argue with that, can you?
Scored 46, conceded 7.
Yeah, can't argue with that.
You know, and you know, I've always said, people train on 3G pitches, but you do have an advantage playing at home on a 3G pitch. I'm convinced of that. Really am.
It's interesting. Why I say interesting? All clubs now are by and large training on them anyway. So all clubs are used to them.
But it's still got to be an advantage to have one at home, I think. Who's got them in our league? Let's go from the top.
Wow. Okay.
Avro.
Yep.
7-1-4. So played 1-7, drew 1, lost 4. So that's positive. AFC Liverpool, 10-1-3, which is great. You know, Lower Breck, 7-2-5. So that's positive as well.
I'd say that's mixed.
Yeah,
that's but it's still, you know.
7-2-5 is still 7 wins and 5 losses. It's still positive.
Trust. Yeah, yeah.
Lidl and Rem. Oh, no, they haven't got one, have they?
No.
First goal, 3-2-8. So that's one the other way. First Division North, Pilks have got one, 8-1-1.
Yeah, but Pilks are an exception to the rule, aren't they?
Yeah, Ilkley Town, 5-0-4. I can't believe they've only had 9 home games, Ilkley.
Yeah.
Christ. I mean, Pilks have only had 7 away games. What's going on there?
Hey, Martin, come on, pull your finger out. Start levelling the games up.
Anyway. Daisy Hill, no, Darwin. Steeton, 4-2-4, so that's split down the middle. South Liverpool, 3-0-8. Yeah, I'm losing my own argument here, aren't I?
A little bit.
But, anyway.
It's good for getting games on. If you run your own grounds, you can make money off them.
Yeah.
Great. But as for any specific advantage, I think year on year now, as more and more clubs are getting access to these 3G pitches, I won't say 4G, because Alan Alcock will always come on to me, there's only 3G, which is, yeah, and yourself, yeah. But as more and more clubs get them, it's becoming the norm, and I think clubs are getting used to playing on them.
I'll tell you one thing, if they cost a quid, I'd buy one tomorrow for Runcorn Town.
Of course you would.
Oh, definitely would. Without a shadow of a doubt, have a 3G pitch.
Yeah, because for that quid, you'd make your quid back over the course of 2 years by renting out to Stocksdale under 12s.
Yeah, the only reason we don't have one, and a lot of other clubs won't have one, is, you know, whatever it's called now, the Premier League Stadium Fund. What is it? Is it called now?
There's a pitch improvement fund, Fund as well, isn't there?
Well, yeah, but I think that's been renamed the Premier League Fund now.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Fund 3G pitches at football clubs. Why? Yeah. Stupid. Why?
I think another aspect for a bit of a counter on that, only a slight one, is that these things can be quite high maintenance by way of getting a crumb on them. And obviously, they've got a lifespan of 9 years. So
yeah,
when it gets to 9 years, you need another one. And they ain't cheap to put in.
Well, they're not.
About and obviously, you've got to get all the levelling and everything else done.
Yeah, they're about $750,000 now to install.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they're cash-hungry beasts. But if you're savvy enough and you've got a commercial structure which is able to take advantage of it, you can make the money in off letting it out for trading, for whatever.
Of course you can. But this is
where you've got to have it in play.
The Football Foundation need to get smart and invest in football clubs. It's in your freaking title or your company, football. You know, invest in clubs, for God's sake. At least then, money's staying in the game of football. It's not going out. You're not going to schools and renting out pitches at schools and stuff. It's staying within football, and it'll get reinvested in football.
Got to keep the pricing real as well, folks. Some of the prices for renting pitches out there are
exactly. You know, it is. You're looking at 80 quid for a third of a pitch for an hour.
Yeah.
You know, you're like, whoa. And if it's at a school, that money's, that's Joe Bloggs FC paying that school. So that money's going out the game. Whereas if that pitch is at a thingy, then great.
I think that money would be invested in school books, but you know, I'm a certain age, I have expectations, but in reality, it probably isn't.
Well, just invest in football clubs. You know, it's not the school's foundation, it's a football foundation. It's in its title.
Yes. So, should we have a look at Vase's results, Martin?
Oh, yeah, I had a bit of a rant there.
Listen, there's nothing wrong with a bit of a rant and a bit of a debate every now and again, but we still need to have a little look at the Vase, maybe.
Yeah.
And that said, seeing as we went in slightly reverse order, probably best to touch on the most recent Vase game, which was Bury.
Yeah.
Start with Bury and we'll work back. They played Holker on Tuesday night, get around 4-0 winners.
Yeah.
Nice gate of 400 as well. Decent game of football by all accounts. Yeah, fair play.
Yeah, so Bury, I'll go on to the draw at the end.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, all right.
So looking, going back now to Saturday.
Yeah.
Congleton, impressive 4-0 win against Pinchbeck United.
Yeah.
Ecclesfield and AFC Liverpool, they're due to play soon, aren't they?
Yeah, that was postponed because of a waterlogged pitch last Saturday, so that's rearranged for next Saturday.
Yeah, I thought it was soon. West Didsbury beat Horden Community Welfare, and you and I, Martin, are well documented as pointing out that a lot of these clubs with welfare on the end of them, they're pretty tough as nails, so that's quite an impressive win.
Yeah, although Horden Community Welfare are not Yorkshire like a lot of them. They're from the north.
No. Yeah.
You know, that's the... They're the last club standing in the north in the from the Northern League. When's the last FA Vase campaign that didn't have a Northern League team in the last 16? Wow.
That is a sign of the times, Mr. Fallon.
Gotta be.
Well debated restructuring and clubs getting a little bit of ambition. And clubs also not being allowed to hide behind non-promotion.
Yep.
Dare I say.
Exactly. I agree. So
okay,
and I've got to say West Didsbury and Charlton as well. 1,019 at that game.
Why does it?
Well, is it, their supporters can carry them all the way. To be honest,
of course they can.
You get a decent draw. If they got drawn at home, you know, you look at Rylands the other year when they got to Wembley, they got lucky with the draw. And every draw was at home. But I guess West will take people on the road as well. They'll take a good couple of away games. So. You know,
it goes to show as well, doesn't it? If you build it, they will come. And West have done well over the years. I think there's a lot of scope. I'm going to come to you a wee bit later on for your predictions for the league titles, Martin. But whilst we're on the subject of the Vase now, could I pressure for who you think is most likely to get through to the later stages, if any?
Let's have a look in a minute. The most surprising thing from Saturday, I think, nationally, was that out of 16 FA Vase ties, there was only three that went ahead.
Yeah, fair comments.
So I didn't realise that until the draw was made, and it was like, such and such, or such and such, against such and such, or such.
Yeah.
I was like, wow.
They were dropping like flies. So, and they were dropping from Friday night as well.
Can I have another rant?
It's really early. Go on, by the way.
So the draw was made on Monday, which I'll come to in a minute.
And last
16 of a national competition, and they're doing north and south divide. What is that all about? It's ridiculous.
We've had this debate before, haven't we? We think that it should be nationalised quite a bit earlier.
Yeah, the last 32 should be nationalised. The last 64 should be nationalised.
Let's have a nice little away day. So let's say West Didsbury and Charlton away at Mousel or Penzance.
Somewhere in Devon. Somebody never play.
Can you imagine West on the road in Cornwall? They'd all be surfing towards Cornwall and they'd start on the ship canal and they'd finish up in Cornwall because they're that cool.
Well, that's what the FA Vase is about. Going and you know, 3 hours on a coach, whatever, going to complete random places and... A
couple of cans of scald.
Yeah, that's what it's about. You know, for the last 16, well, it's going to be quarter-final is the first time it's national draw, which is...
Oh, at least.
Completely...
At least.
It needs to be the, you know, the last 32 or even the last 64. Stop all this north-south, three or four different zones, rubbish.
Can you not use your influence at the FA to get this sorted, Martin?
You know what? I'm going to write a letter.
You're good at that.
I am.
Kick ass.
I'm going to write.
And we'll all be saying to you next season, you're very welcome, Martin.
I just don't understand. It's a national competition.
I'll be putting my signature on this one either.
Signed Gary Langley, yeah.
I get that a lot. Anyway.
Anyway, the moving. Draw. The draw.
Yes.
Draw. So, obviously, it's a north and south draw. Bizarrely. So, we had...
Sadly.
Well, as you say, we got Congleton Town, West Didsbury and Charlton, Bury, AFC, and potentially AFC Liverpool. So, we got four teams, you know, out the eight that was in that half. And, amazingly, they managed to avoid each other, all of them.
Yes.
Which is what we want.
Absolutely.
So, Congleton Town face a trip to AFC Wolverhampton.
And not an unfamiliar name in recent years.
But not an unfamiliar name this season, to be honest, because, you know, they played Brockton earlier this season in the Vase. So, yep. You know, they can get in touch with Brockton. How did they play? What were they like? Have you got the VO footage? Whatever. Let's help each other out, teams. That's what it's about.
Team counties.
Yeah, exactly.
No, I'm not going to kiss the badge because no matter, I'll rip my neck.
Not three lions on the shirt. It's... What are them?
Hold on, you might have three lions on there, you know.
Well, they're... I don't know what they are. They're from Lancashire, aren't they? And they're from Cheshire.
Yeah. Lancashire, Cheshire, yeah. Yeah.
The Cheshire's the Fleur de Leaves. I remember that from Scouts. Because I had on my badge in Scouts. I don't know what they're like. I don't know what they are.
Just want to point out as well that when I was in Cubs, I was a second and a sixer.
Ooh.
Not that it gave me much of an advantage in later life, but hey ho.
No. West Didsbury and Charlton, they got an away trip to either Biggleswade United or Coventry Sphinx.
Up the Sphinx. They're my team in our little chart.
Yeah, they are, yeah.
Hello. If we get beat by Biggleswade, me and Gillan Balagay will be on the same page.
Yeah.
Not the first time, I hasten to add.
Yeah. So, yeah, as you say, Gillan Balagay, the well-respected journalist and pundit and author of all his autobiography. Not biography. Anyway.
Did you read the Spanish version of it? Because you'd be quite a traveling person.
Nah, don't speak Spanish. Anyway, forgot what was up. So yeah, they play this coming Saturday, Biggleswade and Coventry Sphinx, because their game was off. Mm-hmm. Who else got through? Bury AFC got through, didn't they? So yeah. They're away at either Tring Athletic or Walsall Wood.
Two cracking teams, by the way.
Yeah. So Tring's just about 30 miles north of London, central London.
Yeah.
I always remember Tring because it's on the West Coast Main Line going to London. Whenever you go, you see it going past and you go, Tring. Anyway, that's just me. Yeah. Or Walsall Wood. Obviously, Walsall, a number of teams have played Walsall over the last few years. You had...
Absolutely beastly. I watched them a few years back when they played Ryland's. I think it was the Vase semi.
Yeah,
and I was very lucky because I had the golden ticket because it was pandemic time, so I went as league rep, so I was actually able to watch a game of football. I think it was covering it for a local paper as well, and they were absolutely solid. And you've got to remember, this Ryland side went too shabby at the time, but yeah. they fought Ryland on every corner of that park.
Yeah.
But they've been like that for years. They've got a really good. You must have a good scouting network or a manager with a good phone book.
Yeah, well, Walsall, well, like you say, they've been knocking on the door a few times. They got to the quarters once, got to the semis against Rylands when they got there. So, yeah, that should be a great game, that. Bury AFC against one of them two. And AFC Liverpool, should they overcome Eccleshill United, I'll face Atherstone Town or Harpury University.
I don't know much about either of them, but I'm sure I've seen Atherstone as an away team somewhere.
Let me tell you, Gary.
Please regale us with a tale.
So, Eccleshill United. Not going to discuss them because I'm not. They're from Bradford. That's who they're playing. Hopefully win.
As seen on Police Interceptors.
Yeah. Atherstone United. So, Atherstone's basically... it's in North Warwickshire, but... They're not far from the Staffordshire border, so...
Not to be confused with Atherton.
No, Atherstone. So basically, every year on Shrove Tuesday, they have what's called a Shrove Tuesday ball game in Atherstone. And basically, it's a ball that is made specifically for this event. It starts at the local conservative club at 1 o'clock. Someone gets on the balcony, throws the ball down. And basically, you've got to get from one end of the street to the other. There's two different teams. And whoever has possession of the ball at 5 o'clock wins. So this tradition started in 1199. So, you know, what's that, 830 years ago?
Hey?
1199.
What century are you living in, Brother Fallon?
1199.
Yeah, so just say 1200. Let's round it off for cash.
Yeah, so 820 years ago. And it's been played every single year, apart from one, which was when COVID happened. So, yeah, it's the annual Shrove Tuesday ball game, which...
Blow me down with a wet fish.
Yeah, there's not many rules, apparently. One is that you're not allowed to injure it. You're not allowed to kill anybody, which is a bit of a weird rule.
Safety first, yeah. That seems legit.
Yeah. And two is that the possession of the ball has got to be in the main street. That's it.
I wonder if they smother it in, like, lemon and sugar and
stuff. There's got to be something on YouTube about this. It's been going 820 years. So. Anyway, but the other one, Hartbury University. Have you heard of them?
I've heard of Hartbury. I've not heard of the university, though. That might be in a rugby sense. Rings a bell.
It's a very interesting concept, this. So, Hartbury University are based down in Gloucestershire, near Gloucester.
Right.
And basically 2 years ago, they decided to start a football team, you know, which they did. I think they got put in a Step 7 league last season, which they've got promoted. So this is their first season in the National League system. It's the first season in the FA Vase, you know, and they're currently second in the league and they're in the last 16 of the Vase. So, you know, they're doing well. But it's basically the team was set up by the university in order to give... you know, people on sports degrees, the opportunity to learn practically and stuff. And basically, that's like, think Edgehill University setting up a football team. That's what it is.
Don't give them any ideas, because they probably would.
But don't you think that's a great idea?
I got it as well.
Don't you think that's a good idea?
It is, but it'll be another cage. It'll be another three.
Yeah, but...
it makes sense. It does make sense.
Develop it how they want. You know, but I think that's a great idea.
So what time was that pancake bowl thing?
1199.
Is that what the name of the town was, yeah?
No, it's Atherstone.
Right, okay. Sorry, I'm utterly intrigued by this.
Just Google Shrove Tuesday ball game.
I haven't, it's not on there.
Have we not?
Atherstone. Not Atherstone. Shrove... Tuesday.
Well, while you Google that, anyway, because this is the rest of the draw.
A town. It is a thing.
Of course, it's a thing.
What a heap of interesting factual history.
Do you think I was just making that up?
Anyway, so yeah, the Vase, love it, love the Vase.
Yeah. So yeah, the rest of the draw, I'm not going to bother with, to be honest. But one interesting one is that when we were at Wembley the other year, we watched Newport Pagnell Town.
We did.
Yeah, well, they're still in it.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah. There was one thing.
Interesting to see if they can get through again. Teams have a habit of doing that, don't they? If they can, by and large, keep the nucleus of a successful side, they do tend to sort of have runs in it over.
And Jersey Bulls are still in it as well.
Interesting.
It would be.
It would be, yeah.
Another rant on the podcast. Winners will pick up £2,250 from the FA prize fund, with losers picking up £725. How ridiculous.
If you book the right coach company, you can claim that amount in expenses from your opposition.
How ridiculous. £2,250.
I hope one of the TV companies, because obviously we've been there, who's the guy who does Frankie Fryer on Sky, was going past and I was a little bit starstruck. And a couple of other folk from, I think it was BT Sport at the time, were showing it on the day, which is quite interesting. But hopefully they get some money out of that as well. But yeah,
isn't that ridiculous? You know, you get more money from winning three rounds in the FA Cup than reaching the semi-final of the FA Cup.
Or winning the club's last man standing.
I just think that's wrong. I just think it's wrong.
It is. It'd be interesting to see what the trophy winners pick up, but I bet it's probably not much more.
But 25 grand, you think they pick up? But imagine how much cost you've got for hotels for 40 people for two nights, coaches. Wouldn't be much change left.
You'd have to strike a deal, wouldn't you? You'd have to sort of say to your own sponsors, listen, would you mind if we got the Daily Mirror in as a sponsor for one game? Or sell your soul to a TV company or a radio station, wouldn't you?
On your own sponsors, anyway. So, yeah, that's the FA Vase. What did you say? Who do we fancy?
Yeah, who do you fancy based on who's left in it? From our side, let's be positive. Who are you expecting from the counties to mount the most serious challenge?
Do you think we could? Mr. Fallon? We've got potentially four in the last 16.
I'd like all four to make the semis.
Could you imagine that? It'd just be like, yeah. You know what I mean? And on all Northwest counties semi final, where you know, imagine losing that game. Oh, it doesn't bear thinking.
What a semi. Yeah. Suppose so. You'd be in demand as well because you are the media team. I'm not on the media team. You'd be in much demand for the whole of that weekend and the finals weekend.
I know. Crazy.
Mr. Fallon on a beeb.
But yeah, I'd love to see any of our teams get there. I always would. If it's two of them, even better, to be honest.
It'd be nice to see one of our sides in the final again. Not alien territory for us. We hasten to add.
And all of them have got a great shout for different reasons. You know, we touched on West Didsbury and the support. Congleton Town, big team at our level. You know, they are. They get decent support at home. Yeah, love to see them do there. They've got to the last, you know, I think this is the second year running. They've got, the second time in 3 years they've got to the fifth round. So they've been doing well. Bury, I'd love to see there. You know, would Bury?
Can you imagine how many they take down?
Watch Bury AFC go to Wembley to watch it. Who knows?
I really don't understand the animosity between the two parties. Hopefully they'll get it sorted.
Yeah. Well, my opinion.
Can you imagine how many they take?
They've got to merge. They've got to join together. And I'll tell you,
thousands down there.
If they did, they'd be such a force. They'd just go.
Oh, yeah. They just do a Macclesfield, but without the drama.
Yeah. And AFC Liverpool, you know, for traditional proper.
Never rule AFC for
North West Counties team, aren't they?
Good, solid side. Never rule them out for anything. Never know.
So, yeah, I'd love to see any of them get there. But best of luck to all of them, really.
Absolutely.
Outside of us, not bothered, really. Jersey Bulls would be interesting if they were there, I think.
Are Bedfont Sports still in it? Not Bedfont Sports. They're the trophy side. Never mind. It's all right. I was looking down the other week through clubs that I've been to, and there was quite a few familiar names in there. Right, Martin, I appreciate that we're set now 51 minutes into this podcast already, so there's a few things to cover. Do you want to have a look at the league tables? Rather than go over the sketchy results, do you want to have a little look at the current league standings as we go into what could be a busy weekend?
Yeah. I've not even looked at fixtures for this weekend. Do you think then he's going to go ahead? Runcorn Town's got Cleeta Moore Celtic this weekend, and we've already spoken and said, highly doubt this game's going to be on.
Yeah. Well, not many clubs will use that graphic with the double thumbs up coming out of the ground of a pond.
Well, there's snow on the pitch. I mean, it's going to be -2 Friday into Saturday.
I think it'll be a tough weekend to find a game. I know I'm playing it safe. I'm staying local. I'm South Liverpool versus Abbey Fulton.
Well, even 3G pitches
again, it goes down to frost or ice. Yeah, should exactly. If it rains and freezes, then even a 3G pitch, there's nothing set in stone. Yeah.
So our U team training was called off tonight on a 3G pitch. First team training was called off tonight on a 3G pitch. It's, you know, so it doesn't bode well for Saturday for any football, really.
No. It's not looking good.
Yeah, the league table. Premier Division, Vauxhall Motors lead the way with 57 points from 25 games. 2 points behind are Withenshaw Town, who's played a game more. Avro, 53 points, and AFC Liverpool, 52 points. They both played 26, the same as Withenshaw. So, yeah, like I say, 5 points separating the top four. And then, you know, further down, you can't rule out Congleton. You can't rule out Bury, who've got games in hand. So it's looking like it could be a cracking end to the season, this.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And I think if you rewind to episode one of this season, I said it's going to be one of them seasons in the Premier Division where there'll be four or five teams competing against it, and whoever serve will get it. Because nobody stood out this year.
So, no, that's it. There's been no...
Like I said, everyone can beat everyone.
Yeah.
You know, Vauxhall can blooming go to Withenshaw and win 3-0, and then you can see them losing their own to Ashton or something random like that, because that's what this season's all about. It's weird.
I think once we get past, say, mid-February and the games start becoming more and more regular again, reliable, I think it's going to be great for the fans and, you know, the likes of ourselves to get about to go and see regular, mega competitive football with a lot riding on it. I think it's got the makings of a cracking close season, running towards the close season. Yeah. Should we say it's going to be great? Loads of games.
Bottom of the Premier Division, Ashton Athletic on 8 points. Zero home wins with only one draw. You know, at home, they've only picked up 1 point at home, which is not good. And they're, 13 points behind Burscoe, who are second bottom. So they've got it all.
It's not been a great season.
Not for Ashton. But, well, that's what I'll tell you what, that's one game we didn't cover midweek. Lancashire Trophy. They went to Radcliffe of the Northern League, drew 1-1, and then knocked them out, winning 5-4 on penalties. So, got to say, that's going to give them a massive boost. That shows what they can do within the team. And, you know, if they can translate that into a league game, if they can get any on, that is.
Makes the manager's job easy, doesn't it? Oh, you've done it before, you've done it this way. Why can't you do it again?
Yeah, but 13 points, it's a lot to catch up, to be honest.
It really is. And then it's not just the 13 points, it's the points that the clubs above them are going to clock up while you're getting those 13 points back. I don't want to suggest that to go down, but it's looking ominous for them.
Yeah, but the second bottom position, you've got Burscoe 21 points, and then you've got Burscoe, Longridge, Litherland, Squiresgate, FC Isle of Man and Winsford all within 6 points.
One of those would be looking over the shoulder, comfortably looking over the shoulder, thinking we need X more points here.
Well, it's usually about 38 points, 40 points.
Yeah, 38, 39,
So, you know, there's a long way to go there at the bottom. A lot of them teams have got to play each other still. So, yeah, some massive games coming up.
Some massive teams involved. Yeah.
Pardon?
I was going to say some massive teams involved in that relegation fight. One or two who I wouldn't have thought at the start of the season, but that's the type of season it's been.
No. Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Division One North. See, my pick at the start of the season was right up there, up the chat.
Yeah, it is, yeah. Just behind my pick for the season. So, yeah, Pilkington lead.
Call you safe hands, Fallon.
Pilkington lead the way with 44 points from 17 games. Ridiculous season. They've only lost one game all season. They've only conceded 13 goals all season in the league.
Massive changes on and off the park. They've really gone for it. They've all sat down, all interested parties, and thought, right, what do we need to do here to have a crack at it?
Yeah.
And they've got it right in all angles.
Yeah, the goal difference is virtually double anyone else in the division, which is crazy. So, yeah, it's Pilkington there sitting top. 3 points clear of Chadderton, as you say, with the game in hand. You've got Exton Villa in third, who are a further 4 points behind Chadderton. Ilkley Town in fourth place, two points behind Exton with the game in hand.
Played 17, but not many at home.
Say again, sorry?
Played 17, but not many at home.
Only 9 at home, but interesting with Ilkley. 1-6, drew 2 on the road, undefeated on the road this season, Ilkley.
Not bad at all.
No, not bad at all, no. And FC St Helens in 5th place with 31 points from 18 games. So, Exton and FC St Helens in the playoffs, both new to the division. Ilkley Town, who only survived on the last day of last season, you know, they needed a win to leapfrog AFC Darwin. It proved irrelevant, but he only survived on the last day. Chadderton apart, are you surprised that those teams have been in the playoffs?
No, not really. I think we all, at the start of the season when we looked at things, Exton Villa, we weren't quite sure about, although there was potential. FC St Helens, I think they were both of our dark horses to do well, but we just didn't know how quickly they'd do well. Yeah. And I think they've been quite sensible. They found a feat. Ilkley, admittedly, I'm surprised by Ilkley, not surprised by Chadderton. Daisy Hill seemed to be sitting quite nicely. But obviously, you've got the Holker effect. They've only played 15 games.
They had a really good FA Vase run, which they're now out of. So it's concentrate on the league and get back into that playoff picture.
But you know, you look at that, they're your usual suspects, plus the perhaps expected new suspects.
Yeah. Holker, like you say, 28 points they've got from 15 games. You know, one win, they're virtually in the playoffs then, so it's just a matter of getting up there and seeing. But it's going to be a cracking race for them playoff places, I think, this season. Same as last year, you'd have Bacup and Chadderton and was it Nelson? Pipped them all to the playoffs.
Which
is great. The bottom of the division, got Cleetamore Celtic bottom with 10 points from 16 games. Ashton Town above them, 11 points from 18 games. And then Runcorn Town with 14 points from 18 games. They're the current bottom three. Let's say 4 points ahead of Runcorn. You've got Nelson, Atherton and Bacup sort of within that. But Bacup have got Rooker game in hand. They've only played 13. Ridiculous.
I'm going to be controversial here, Mr. Fallon.
Yeah.
I think the bottom of Division 1 North is refreshingly tight and open because no teams have really wanted to get away from that relegation zone. No one's really bust the buns and thought, we're getting away from it. That there's at least 8, 9, 10 sides there who really should be looking to get away from that zone. When you look at the amount of points scored, I don't think the amount of points scored warrants the games they played. That's my opinion.
Just one exception to that is Darwin FC, who, you know, they basically won their last 4 games.
Saw Darwin till the week.
So basically, you know, they won 7-0, 4-1, 1-0 and 3-2 the last 4 games going back to Boxing Day. They was pretty much third, fourth, bottom, and they've just gone woof. So that's probably why you've not seen them, because they've propelled themselves well out. They're up to 8th place now. So, you know, them take 12 points off that, but you're on 13. Yeah, they were down there in the bottom three, and they've gone right up to 8th with a fantastic run.
Highly motivated squad there as well. Saw them till the week.
Yeah, but that just doesn't that highlight any of the bottom 8, like you say, that you can do this run, just put a run together.
Yeah, and it's not easier said than done. A bit of motivation, but a bit of put your minds to it. Well, crack on and get up, because we tend to see sides at the bottom of the Division Ones who are pretty stagnant. And they stay there all season. But all of these clubs are capable of pulling away and getting up. And most of them tend to pull the socks up towards the end of the season and they just avoid the drop. And you and I can probably name 3 or 4 clubs in that bottom 6 or 7 who every season for the last 4 or 5 have been really sketchy on the verge of going down. But this season, there seems to be a few clubs that just seem to want to chance their hand. Remember St Helens Town, folks. Don't chance it. Get the points on the board. Get up the table.
Well, I mean, I was speaking with Ron Cortal's manager earlier today, because obviously,
I'd like to think you would. You are club secretary after all.
Yeah, we were talking about, you know, this weather and Saturday's game, and you know, it's just killing us that we can't get games on. I mean, just looking since the start of December, we've played four games.
Yeah, it's not great. Yeah.
And he said, it's killing us. And I said to him, it is, but on the flip side, it's killing everyone. Yeah. Everyone's momentum's gone. So it's like when this cold spell ends, is, you know, every club's basically hitting the reset button and going, right, we're going into it with no momentum. Let's get going.
It's worth pointing out as well, there's a lot of player registration going in as well. So players tend to be, or let's say clubs are starting to get all of their pieces in, ready for that running for the end of the season. So a lot of managers aren't just sitting on their hands. They're getting the squads ready for when the games come thick and fast.
Yeah. So
interesting. Yeah.
That's the North Division. So in the South Division, which is I've completely lost, Scotport Town are top.
Yeah.
Phenomenal.
What a title race.
Phenomenal.
What a title race.
Yeah, so 28 points from 22, 58 points, sorry, from 22 games. 11 wins out of 11 at home. You know, they're doing great guns, Stockport. Withenshaw Amateurs, 56 points from 22 games, so only 2 points behind. Played the same number of games. Stockport got a miles better goal difference. As I said, their home form was phenomenal. I think we always thought Withenshaw would be up there. But beneath them, Brockton, 21, played 21, 47 points. So they're 9 behind Withenshaw Amateurs in second. Sandbach United, the perennial underachievers, who have finally got their act together in the player position. 24 games played, 44 points. And then Ellesmere Rangers underneath them played 21, 40 points. So, you know, Sandbach have played more games than anyone, but crucially, they have got points on the board. Underneath that, you know, Stockport, Georgians, Cheadle Town, they'll be fancying the chances of making the playoffs, considering they've both got four games in hand on Sandbach. But that's 12 points, and Sandbach are 9 ahead of them. So you'd rather be in Sandbach's position, I think.
Yeah, for sure.
Any of them surprise you?
Sandbach, yes. As much as I expect them to do well. I'm going to say as well, Brockton and Ellesmere. Last season weren't great, but this season doing well. Stockport Georgians, like with any new team, Martin, they're either going to go great guns or they're going to go.
Yeah, but you only have to rewind to episode 7 or 8 this season. They were struggling at the bottom of that division.
I get you, but
they're on the fringes of the playoffs now. So, and don't forget, they've only. Most teams have played, 20 to 22 games. That's out of 38. There's still pretty much half a season to go.
Yeah, I get you.
Anyone's. At the bottom, you've got Roaster, who, you know, 8 points from 21 games have Roaster. And then now level on points with Foley Mia, also on 8 points. And that's because Roaster are actually unbeaten in the last four games with 2 wins and 2 draws. So, is it too late? Is the great fight?
For me, my own personal opinion, I hasten to add, is that the bottom two are going to go in each of the Division Ones. So, both of those two are really going to have to go great guns. Alsager probably need 15 more points. Cheatley's
I was going to say, just to round off, Alsager's 21 played, 17 points. So, they're, 9 points ahead of the bottom two. But I think it's crucial to point out here that, you know, how the relegation works is that the bottom three are liable to be relegated. That's how it works. So you have your promotion candidates from the county feeder leagues.
We'll get to in a minute.
If you're bottom, you're virtually done. You're virtually relegated because, you know, second bottom, third bottom, you've got a chance to get out of it, depending on the number of applicants. But your points per game have got to be as high as possible. So every point counts. You know, Foley Mayor are not competing with Alsager Town or Roaster. They're competing with every other league at our level. So they've got whoever finishes second bottom or third bottom has got to have really good points per game to maximise their chances of staying up.
And when you look at a lot of these leagues, Martin, you know, with the exception of maybe two or three, a lot of the leagues are pushing on. So
I've not looked. Give me a league. Give me a random league at our level.
Combined counties.
Combined counties north. Combined counties league. I'll have a look while you're doing it. So the table filled by division. Division one of the combined counties. And why did you pick that? Have you seen who's top of the combined counties league division one?
Go on.
Langley. What's the chances? Did you know that? No.
They may or may not be on my radar for a couple of games this season yet.
Brilliant. Followed by FC Deportivo Galicia. Wow.
Yeah. Galicia.
Yeah. So, yeah, just looking at them, Hillingdon Borough bottom, but they've got 13 points.
What I mean, and it's not an isolated case either.
No, Hounslow United 15 points, Penn and Tyler's Green 15 points. So you can see, you know, Foley Mayor and Roaster in comparison to that league will be well below them on the points per game. So it's important you pick up as many points as possible. It really is.
It's interesting as well because normally at this time of year, and we'll get to the applicants in a bit, but now you start seeing all these hobbyists who start predicting who's going to go in which league where, based entirely on their own opinion and sending out 3,000 emails to people, will start predicting who's going to be up, down, and fly around and panicking clubs. As you said, Martin, those clubs need to forget about the league table in effect and start racking up the points. Go get some dual-reg players in. Go out and train twice a week in the snow. Yeah. Do what you need to do to just rack up a few points.
Yeah, because, you know, every point can make a difference.
Absolutely, yeah. And you, for some, it could go down to minute 0.05 or whatever.
It will do. On that PBG. There'll be nothing between them two teams at that core point.
Yeah. No. That's important. Right, Martin. What I'm going to do, because whilst we're on the subject of these tables, I was going to put you on the spot and get both of our predictions just for the league titles. Do you want to do that now before we go on to the league applicants and the ground off?
I'm still sticking with mine. Withenshaw Town, Pilkington and Withenshaw Amateurs. You know, the second, first and second. So,
okay. I'm going to go Vauxhalls, Pilks and Stockport Town.
I don't think anyone predicted Vauxhall at the start of the season. Do you know what we need to do for next season? Just while we're talking about it. We need to get a panel of 10 people, listeners, famous people, whatever, just to predict who's going to be the top three. And then
it'd be interesting to see how that pan out.
It would, wouldn't it?
Yeah, would. Right. So there you go. Season 20. We're all in. Season 20? Season 10. There you go. We're already starting to get that structure in place. Yeah. We also need to do a live one somewhere as well. We've not forgot about it. We just, like, let's get the basic ones out first and get some football played. And then we'll start worrying about live ones.
Maybe at the Groundhop.
We'll come to that in a minute. Right.
How long is this podcast?
Yeah, I know. We slightly went over there. So, right, new applicants. They came out in midweek and then everyone started getting a little bit nervous and anxious and started plotting who's going where and who's going to do what. God knows who's going to make the grade, who's going to go get promoted in the top five. So the clubs, roughly for our area, which everyone is sort of going by the bye. Right, I'm going to fire them out. MSB Walton, based in Liverpool at the Simpson Ground. Probably needs a bit of work doing. I'll come to you on these in a minute, Mark. Garswood United, former members of the league. Ground probably needs a bit of a tidy up and some floodlight planning. Edgerton, been pushing for some time to get into the counties. Winstanley Warriors, recently started coming on the radar over the last two or three seasons. They play out a little lane at Wigan. Potentially could do it. St. Helens Town. Shelley.
Let's just concentrate on them five you've said for now.
Yeah, let's have a look at the merits of them.
Because they are what we'd call in our traditional area.
Yeah.
The likes of Shelley we can come on to because they have been coming into our league over the coming years because of
the boundaries. They're always going to be on the radar, aren't they? I was genuinely surprised, though, that after the way they left Step 6 and for the very valid reasons for doing so.
Let's come back on that in a minute, because these others
are... MSB won't...
Yeah, they play in the Liverpool County Premier League. It's currently top of the division. So, you know, the criteria, for those who don't know, you've got to finish in the top five of your league, which, like I say, in their case, is the Liverpool County Premier League. And you've got to meet what's called Ground Grade 7, which is formerly known as Grade H. They've redone all the gradings so that they match the steps, you know. So if you want to go to Step 4, you've got to get to Grade 4. It actually makes sense, to be honest.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you've got to meet MT Ground Grade 7 by the 31st of March, which... It's basically getting everything right. I think you don't need your seats in there. You don't need your floodlights in. You've got to meet that one, and then you've got to get them in by the year after. So
you've got to have that commitment to do it, though, haven't you? You can't just say, "Do you know what? We've got this field, but give us some time. We'll work on it."
It is achievable for clubs. It really is achievable for clubs to get the ground grading in. So basically, it's just a matter of finishing top five, really.
Yeah.
I think for anyone who's actually spent the £120 and applied, they'll be confident enough that they'll meet the graded, I think. So it'll all depend. So you've got to say that MSB Walton, for the fact that they have actually applied.
Genuinely surprised me, that one, Martin. I think it surprised a couple of us as well when we saw that come out, because, it's one of these hubs. You've not been to Simpson now?
No,
but it's similar to South Liverpool. All the facilities are behind one of the goals. Needs tinkering. Probably needs a bit of work doing on it. But they've got a couple of months to do it, so it's all going to be sorted, done and dusted. 31st of March, I think.
Yeah,
and so it's doable. But
and what will have happened with all five of these clubs, I guess and I presume, is, you know, the Northwest Counties have been really proactive in recent years, doing advisory ground grading visits for any clubs who want to progress into the league. There's been, you know, there's got to be 20 clubs that have, you know, Jeff Wilkinson and his esteemed team have been to give advisory ground grading. Some have gone, thank you very much, you give us a list, we'll be in touch in the next 3 years when we've done that list. Oh, we're actually not that far away. So I suspect all five of them teams will have had their advisory ground grading visits, so they know exactly what they need to do, and they'll have been working towards getting that grading. From the Liverpool, you've got to finish top five, and it's whoever finishes highest. Will get promoted. You can't have more than one team promoted from each league. So from the Liverpool County League perspective, you've got MSB Walton and you've got St Helens Town who've applied. Now, St Helens Town, for those who have not looked at that league, are actually struggling big style. Once again, they've only won 2 out of 16 league games, so they're at the wrong end of the table. You know, in fact, they're going to be going out of that division the other way. You know,
that's surprising, but you've got to have the ambition, fair play. But they've got bigger problems to fix there. I thought, I was surprised by it. But, you know, fair play. Guardsford United,
nobody else surprised you? If they were the only applicants, then it might have done them good.
They might have a sniff.
Yeah.
But if they can't hack it in the Liverpool County Prem at the moment, if they were to get back into the counties, they'd have the same problem, but with more travelling.
Yeah.
So you've got to look at the bigger picture. So, Martin, Garswood United, familiar name for some who have been around the county scene for maybe 10 years or more.
Yeah.
It's been a while, but they were members at one point.
Yeah, so Garswood are actually based near Ashton in Makerfield, the same as Ashton Athletic and Ashton Town. So it'll be a third team from around that area. I think it's nearer to Ashton Town.
It's near Ashton Athletic.
Oh, is it? No, that's
because it's near one of the main Wigan roads there. Oh. It's sort of a team.
Oh, yeah. I have Goldbourne in my head, sorry.
Yeah,
that's the other side. So, yeah, they're from near there. Who else did you say there was?
Edgerton. They've been querying for a while. They're a fine example of what you were saying before, Martin, about how a club can keep in touch with the league and keep developing and getting things ready for when the time's right.
Yeah, I went to Edgerton the other week with our youth team. Nice ground, nice setup, got a decent stand there. They did have some work to do, like putting the pay box in, putting a secure walkway into the ground. But no, you know, having been to the likes of Pilkington's, and there's nothing that's not achievable there. So
yeah, it seems to be the modern template, doesn't it, for certain grounds. I mean, I went on a ground green there, it must be four or five years ago, and they were nowhere near. But they did take the advice well, and they did have a five-year plan. And here we are, probably 4 or 5 years on, and they're applying. So there might be something in it.
Yeah. The Wind Stanley
Warriors,
which are from Wigan.
Highfield area.
Yeah, I don't know much about Wind Stanley Warriors, to be perfectly honest.
They seem to be quite a community club. First team have sort of been lower sort of regions of regional football, but they've pressed on and they've got that ambition to come up. I think there's a few tweaks that they need to make to the ground. But again, you know, depends on what your budget's like and how keen you are to do it.
Yeah.
I think they'd be an interesting addition because since we lost Wigan Northern Park, I always think Wigan and sort of West Lancs are a little bit underrepresented for that area, so that'd be an interesting one.
The only thing with the applicants from the Cheshire League is you've got basically Wind Stanley Warriors in 9th, Garswood 10th, and Edgerton 11th at this current time. So you know they've all got work to do. Garswood have actually got a number of game in hand on the top five, so that they're probably the best place to do it. But yeah, looking at the teams within the, you know, further up the league, I'd like to, you know, AFC Knowsley, they've got a great setup there. They've got a lovely youth setup. It's they're one to watch in the future, I think. AFC Knowsley. I think
they've got floodlights though, and that might be an issue with Lord Derby's lands. I'm not sure, but
I don't know. But they're potentially one. Middlewich, long established in the Cheshire League.
Great club, Middlewich.
You know.
Good catchment areas.
Yeah, so there's some really good teams in there that could progress up. But yeah, those three are basically the battle will be to get into the top five, I think.
Yeah.
So in order to get there. But you did mention some others like Shelley, didn't you?
Shelley and Alscott Heath are on the periphery. Would Shelley really be overjoyed if they got in and got put in the counties? I'm not sure. Lovely club, and they were great in the time in the counties, but they were just a little bit thwarted because of the travel of the thing. I don't think it did them any favours. They must surely be looking towards Northern Counties East.
Well, they'd want to go in that league, I guess, but you get placed where you're placed by the FA, don't you?
And that's the risk that you take, I suppose, when you apply. Obviously, we don't want to go down a situation where, obviously, a club might apply. I'm not referring specifically about Shelley here, but obviously there was a recent example of a club who applied, got in, and then suddenly, whoa, we've got problems here. We can't take the place.
Yeah.
You've got to be serious about what you apply for.
Well, just looking, Shelley are the only applicants from, what is the West Yorkshire Football League, and they're currently second in the table. So you've got to say they're strong. They're quite strong to come in, I think.
Yeah, they'll be in with a sniff for sure. It's just a case of, I hope it works out for whatever league they want to, I mean, if they want to come back into the counties.
Yeah, which they're called Route 1 Rovers, Gary.
Oh, yes, saw that one.
They've applied from the Yorkshire Football League.
They'll be dancing in the streets of Route 1 if they get in.
Yeah, but you know, I mean, one, they'd have to change the name. You can't come into the non-league system called Route 1.
Am I right in thinking that they play? They're looking to play at Marley, which is the ground that Steeton are currently residing at.
Yeah, so you know, they're potentially on the radar to come into the Northern Premier League, the Northern Premier League, Northwest Counties League. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And the other applicant from that one is Leeds University Football Club, which, I think they're too far east. They wouldn't be Northern Counties East, really. But
give us a few years and I'll work on it. We'll try and get out further east.
Yeah. So yeah, there's a couple, like I say, there's those five.
Don't forget Al Scott Heath as well, who are down near Ellesmere.
Birmingham way.
No, they're not a million miles away from Ellesmere.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Towards Birmingham way, that's what I meant. Yeah.
So if you live in Ellesmere, if you consider yourself near Birmingham, give us a shout at us now.
What were they in the Shropshire, perhaps?
Yeah. But again, it's another club who's sort of been on the radar for a few years of a possibility.
I can't see them.
Well, are they step six, essentially laterals already?
Oh, so they could get laterally moved, you mean?
It could be lateraled in. We're not even going to go there with laterals, otherwise...
It's another one here. Dorley Town. Where's Dorley Town? Heard of them?
How are we spelling Dorley? Diana Dawes or Dawes?
Yeah, so they basically play in the Salop Leisure League, which is
Salop Shrewsbury, ain't it?
Salop Shrewsbury, and you know, if you think we've had Ellesmere and stuff like that, so
Dorley Town.
Yeah, Dorley Town.
How do you spell Dorley again?
DAWLEY.
Ah.
So they're called Dorley Town. Oh, the Jockeys. They've got a great badge, I must admit. Oh, fantastic badge.
Dorley Town FC. No matches found.
Well, Dolesley Road playing fields, aren't we? Anyway.
Dorley in.
They're in Dorley.
Near Telford Way.
Yeah.
Hey, South Telford.
Yeah.
Wouldn't surprise me.
So, you know, they're a possible one because, you know, we're going down to Stafford already, aren't we?
Wellington, who were a sort of club on the radar not a long while ago. That's just literally over the M54 from where Dorley is.
I mean, we're guessing, aren't we? We're guessing.
Of course we are. And that's what's important. But we don't want people to go to clubs this week and start tagging them and saying, Gary and Martin said that these clubs are going to get in. Because they might get in. They might even go to the Northern Counties East.
Yeah.
There's all sorts of permutations. But I think what we were saying, because of the release of that list this week, all the speculation is going to start now for months. You're going to get your hobbyists who will be drawing up leagues with them in and then releasing them, saying, our sources told me that they're going in there. Nobody knows until the FA Leagues Committee start getting their heads together and looking at what's what. But there are options there, and those options might indirectly put pressure on those clubs that we were talking about at the bottom of Division 1 North, because if those clubs are serious and the real deal in their league position and their ground grading, then they could well get in, and that will in turn open up the trapdoor a little bit wider.
Yeah, indeed.
In a nutshell.
There's one other team who are not on that list, basically, which is, they've been in the news the last few days on social media, which is Droylsden.
Yes, I think we need to address that discreetly, don't we? Because
basically, with Droylsden, for those who don't know, when the pandemic hit in 2020, you know, and clubs couldn't play football, they made the decision to shut down entirely. From a playing perspective,
yeah, I think we shut down football, didn't we, for the senior teams?
Yeah, that's what I mean. From a playing perspective, the actual entity that's Droylsden, they've still been going, they've still been in the clubhouse and all that, and you know, and now we're out of the pandemic, I think they're, you know, from what I can gather, there was a meeting between supporters and the owner last week, so potentially they're looking to come in, perhaps, you know, I'm guessing,
if there's a vacancy.
So yeah, I was just going to say, so
and that, again, it there's all sorts of permutations with that at the moment. I think it's important to.
I was just going to say, basically, what happens is because they've got to be treated differently because they're an existing football club that who are coming from above, that they're not an applicant from a county feeder league like everybody else. So there's a couple of rules for them, but basically, one of them is that they could only be accepted in if a vacancy exists within the league. And that's after all promotion and relegation issues have been satisfied. So, you know, that list of promotion and relegation, I think, takes priority over any new team that would have come in. So if you think the new team, like FC Isle of Man, for example, who come in recent years, they come in because there was vacancies after all the promotion and relegation have settled. So it just depends, to be honest. Any application from Droylsden, and you know they've not applied as yet, to the best of my knowledge, would be to the FA. It wouldn't be to the league anyway. They'd have to apply to the FA.
I think they need league backing at some point. But we go back even to like to, let's say City Liverpool as an example, that they need to explain what and how they run and everything else. And Martin, just for clarity on that, when you say promotion and relegation all sorted, if there weren't enough suitable applicants to come in and there was still, say for argument's sake, two came down from one division one and three came down from another, would that third place that hadn't been taken for a promotion from the feeder leagues potentially become available then for...
So that big list of teams that we've just gone through, the MSB Walton and Route 1 Rovers and all that, once all they've been sorted and allocated Step 6 leagues, wherever it may be, if there's still vacancies in the National League system, that's when you look at any potential new clubs.
It'd be an interesting addition. But again, we're all speculating, aren't we? Because up until a week ago, Droylsden, everyone was saying, nice club, shame they're not in the league system. Let's get back one day. And then suddenly it went 0-100 miles an hour in one afternoon. Yeah. And then all the speculation started all over the place.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I'd love to see him back as a football club.
I think many of us would. I mean, I remember going there when they were quite away up the pyramid. Yeah. Very warm welcome. Good people that knew the stuff. And a lot of these people seem to be still knocking around.
Yeah, I mean,
again, potentially good.
I know Dave Pace from years ago, the owner of Droylsden. Nice fellow, I've always got on well with him. But, you know, they chose to halt football matters when the pandemic was on. And I don't think anybody can blame them for that. Everybody went through the pandemic in different ways and they did what was best for Droylsden Football Club. Yeah. You know, so now we're on the other side of it and they're looking to restart the football side of the business. And we're all businesses these days. You know, best of luck to them, I say.
Yeah, absolutely. And whatever will be. But please don't harangue the league saying, please take in Droylsden, because we all have very little say in it at all. It all goes down to that FA Leagues Committee down in Wembers, and they'll sort all that out. Don't worry about it. Same with promotion, relegation, acceptance, and everything else. Nobody will know, not even these hobbyists who will release their leaked documents. There's nothing to leak yet.
Well, basically, you say the league will have very little input. That's not true. We'll have zero input. It's up to the...
But all we'll do is support an application. That's as far as we go.
Yeah, exactly.
That's all we get. Yeah, we support applications, then we move on, and then we crack on. We've got League Cup business to sort out and an AGM to plan for.
The days of Runcorn Town going into the AGM saying, hi, I'm Martin Fallon. This is about Runcorn Town. Please accept us into the league. Going out the door and waiting for the league to vote us in. That's all gone now. It's up to the FA.
So if you see leaks and proposed league structures and everything else, now it's guesswork. It's a case of guesswork and speculation. It provides a bit of fun. It's good on social media, and they will undoubtedly come out over the coming weeks.
Yeah,
let Wembley sort out, because they have the ultimate yay and they say, and it's very unlikely you're going to get it.
Nobody knows.
But in the meantime, we've got one hell of a season to get finished off, Martin. And give or take the next couple of weeks where it might be a bit fresh, we've got a lot of games to knock off. So one may continue. Let's get them knocked off. Some great football. And let's see what clubs can do. It's all to play for.
It is, it is.
Right, do you want to have a quick 5-minute Groundhop chat and then we can close this off?
Well, let's have a quick 2-minute fixture chat. So there's fixtures this weekend. One FA Vase fixture, which is AFC Liverpool going to Ecclesfield United.
Good luck to Chris, Mr. Stibber. Let's hope he's a bit of a lucky over for them. We want them to win.
And then there's games in the third round of the Macron Cup. There's the outstanding game in the third round of the Edward Case Cup between Eccleshall and Abbey Hay. And then, you know, games in all three divisions, but limited games because of all them cup games, basically. So how many of these are going to go ahead? I have no idea.
Check your club's social media. Check your club's website. Give your club a call. If you're going to go into a game as a neutral, just keep half an eye on the game.
Yeah, as soon as the league here, i.e. me, I will put it on the league website.
Please feel free to tell Martin.
Yeah, feel free to follow procedure and let us know.
It'd be nice.
But yeah, I can't see many going ahead, to be honest, looking at the weather forecast and, you know, looking at the weather it is now.
Might need a plan B and C, folks.
Yeah, go bowling, temping bowling. That's probably it. It's indoors, it's warm. Sell burgers.
I'm sure you're the man from the league.
Yeah, but
and I don't mean the temping bowling league, the Runcorn and District Pin Angels.
Gary, it's freezing. It's snow.
You've got a hat, haven't you? You're all right, you're in Portugal. You've forgotten what freezing is. Never mind.
Anyway,
do you want to address this this week or next week when we got Rob with us?
Well,
I think it might be worth touching on it though, because people might be looking to book.
Yeah, so you know, we've announced the Groundhop now, which is taking place on Friday the 3rd, Saturday the 4th, and Sunday the 5th of March. Last season we were in the East Yorkshire, East Lancashire and Yorkshire area. You know, we covered Paddyham and Nelson, Barnoldswick, Steeton, Ilkley, etc. So we're going south this year, right to the bottom of the division. So the first game on the Friday is Ellesmere Rangers against Alsage Town. On to the Saturday. We'll start at 11. Oh, that's 7:45 kickoff on the Friday night, by the way. On to the Saturday, and four games on the Saturday on the Groundhop. So we've got Roaster against Sandbach United. That's an 11:00 kickoff. Then on to Foley Mia, which will be a first ever visit there for me. I don't know about yourself, but they're playing Main Road at 2:00 kickoff. After that, Abbey Hulton United against Cheadle Heath Nomads, which is a 4:45 kickoff. And then finally, we'll be knackered by them. Eccleshaw, 7:45 kickoff, Eccleshaw against Barnton. On to the Sunday, and in effect, two games in Stafford. So the first one is 11:45 a.m. Brockton versus Stockport Georgians. And the second game at 2:30 is basically a mile away, Stafford Town versus Abbey Hay. So seven games over the weekend. Feel free to attend. It'll be a feast of football. Some really good games. If you want to book officially, you know, this has been done in conjunction with a company called Groundhop UK. So you can find them on Twitter or on Facebook. They have a hotel which you can book into, which, to be honest, I don't think there's many rooms left. I think there's only two rooms left at the hotel last time I spoke to them.
Cool.
They run a coach between all the grounds and back to the hotel, even picking up at railway stations beforehand. So, you know, if you want to go on the coach between the games, you know, get in touch with them and see what they can do. They offer packages for the games, which include a program from the games. So, yeah. Groundhop UK on Twitter and Facebook. Do what we do, Gary. Rock up to the games. Pay to get in like, you know, everybody else. And you can.
The Langley Mobile will be in full flow unless I convince Jeff Fowler that it's worth me sticking £300 worth of petrol in his car. That's about the going rate these days.
Yeah.
Apparently, according to Jeff. So we'll see. Is it a sustainable Groundhop, Mark?
Yeah, it's carbon neutral. Yeah,
lovely. Right, excellent. Right, so there we have it. Ending on a green note. So there we go, folks. Please like this video if you're watching it on YouTube. Please tell your friends about us. If you don't subscribe, please hit the subscribe button. I'm pointing because I don't know where the subscribe button is, but it helps Martin and his media team develop the media program for the league going forward, and of course spreads the word. You wouldn't get information like this by word of mouth, get it from the horse's mouth, that horse. Anyway, I digress. We're also available on all your usual podcast outlets from wherever you get your audio podcasts from, and we are constantly chirping away at Alexa and whoever else provide podcast to get the one or two gaps that there still are where you can't get it. And of course, there's the County's Podcast website, countyspodcast.co.uk, which has some useful information on Mark, myself, and Rob, some historical stuff on there as well.
Countyspodcast.com.
Countyspodcast.com. There you go. You learn something every day. It's still got all that historical stuff on, some profile stuff for me and Martin, and some contact email addresses as well. If you want to fire a question at us, you can do it on the socials or through the email addresses that are on that site. So anyway, please do the honours for us. It doesn't do anything to your computer if you hit a like. Likewise, if you download the podcast, give it a 5-star rating or a 4 if Martin has offended you in any way. But apart from that, we're done. We need to get out of here. We'll be back next week, hopefully, with Rob in tow as well, and hopefully to discuss the large amount of games that surprise us this weekend by taking place. Martin, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure as always.
Yes, you too, Gary. I need to go and get my tea now. Starving.
Doesn't your tea normally come? Oh, no, it doesn't normally come to you in Portugal. And I've enjoyed myself as well, so it's been a blast. So thank you for watching or listening.
Bye, all.